Genesis 43. We have been studying the life of Joseph. And we've seen that Joseph is a man like Jesus. And in numerous ways, his life and the way he lived his life points forward to the life that our Lord and Savior Jesus would live. And ultimately to the sacrifice that he would make on our behalf. But this particular section, it's about a 3-week long section, beginning last week, including today, and then going into next week. The focus really shifts primarily from Joseph to his 10 brothers. And the heart of this particular portion has to do with God's process of restoring them, of God bringing them back into fellowship with him and fellowship with one another. Now, if you're brand new to us, or maybe just a little review never hurts, these 10 guys had been jealous of their brother Joseph. They'd put him in a pit to try to teach him a lesson, intending to leave him there to die. And then one of the brothers, Judah, came up with the bright idea that it's not all that profitable to kill your brother, actually unbiblical even, so they decided to sell him instead. That way they made a profit and they didn't have his blood on their hands. But they did go back and pretend, deceiving their father, telling him that Joseph had been maimed or mauled, bringing his cloak back, and it was bloody from blood they'd applied to it. So their broken-hearted father thinks Joseph's now deceased. Joseph ends up sold into slavery, and through a miraculous turn of events, not all that quick, maybe not quick enough even for Joseph, he ends up exalted and second in command in all of Egypt. And if you haven't been with us, at least go back later and read the story. It's fascinating. It's mind-blowing. And if you have opportunity, grab the tapes, go through them, some very practical lessons as a result of them. But what we're going to see today is that God is about restoring this family. And whenever God wants to work in restoring our relationships to one another, he's got to restore our relationship first to him. It is important that we understand that when we're out of fellowship with one another, we're out of fellowship with God. We can't walk in darkness and light at the same time. We can't walk in deception and truth at the same time. And so in order to fellowship with God, we have to maintain fellowship with one another. Now, I would think that selling your brother into slavery would break fellowship in the family. I'm sure you have family problems. All families have them. But I doubt that you've been sold into slavery by your brothers or got to pull that off on one of your brothers growing up. And so here's a family in need of restoration. And we see, as always, the process begins with God. He doesn't just kick back and watch to see what happens. He takes an active and aggressive role in restoring people to one another. Why? He wants fellowship with us, and he wants us to enjoy fellowship with one another. He uses a couple different things, and this is going to lead us here in a moment into our study. He uses the law, first of all, to convict us of sin. And then if we don't happen to have a copy of the law or don't, for whatever reason, understand the law, can't comprehend the law, he uses something that's universal, conscience. And we're told that everyone everywhere knows right from wrong. God has written it on our hearts. And so we have a conscience. And these guys' conscience is being activated. It's really happening two ways. First of all, there are exterior pressures placed upon them. God is using all sorts of circumstances and events. He's used a famine. He's used the fact that their brother is exalted, and he's kind of messing with them. And we're going to see him really get into that in this passage. But he uses things external and things internal to simply probe our conscience and to bring us to that place where we're more than remorseful, where we have more than regrets, but we're really willing and wanting and ready to repent. Now, if you don't know the difference in regret, remorse, and repentance, it's this simple. Anybody caught doing anything illegal has regrets. Any sane person who gets caught doing anything illegal has remorse. But you can have all sorts of regrets and remorse and yet not repent. You wouldn't believe how many people I've known over the years who were destroying their lives with drug addiction or alcohol problems or just family unforgiveness and hatred and bitterness and jealousy, but they wouldn't repent. Were they remorseful? Oh yeah, they hated what they did. Did they regret it every day of their lives? But repentance is more than that, and we're going to see it in the passage. One of the most wonderful things about this particular section is we'll see Judah, who was responsible personally for suggesting and negotiating the sale of his brother into slavery, we'll see Judah repent. We're going to get to see what it looks like, and that's going to help some of us who maybe struggle conceptually, you know. Maybe we're not that great of readers, and we don't have great reading comprehension. And so hearing the story or examining the story, seeing it in someone else's life, just makes it come to life. Well, they'd confessed, by the way, during their period of regret and remorse, back in chapter 42 last time, they confessed, we're guilty, we're busted. And then one of the brothers, Reuben, I think it was, said, you're guilty. And not that he didn't feel he was, but he said, I told you that we shouldn't have done this to him. And then there was all sorts of anxiety and fear, and we're going to see that that continues even into this particular portion. Well, chapter 43, our story begins again. The famine was severe in the land. It came to pass when they'd eaten up the grain which they'd brought from Egypt, that their father said to them, go back and buy us a little food. But Judah spoke to him, saying, the man solemnly warned us, saying, you shall not see my face unless your brother is with you. Now, if you weren't here, this guy Joseph, who's now second in command in all of Egypt and overseeing the distribution of food during the famine, he's got 10 half-brothers, but he has one whole brother, full brother, and he wants to see his little brother Benjamin. And so as they're sharing their sort of life story during a guilty outburst, he says, well, listen, if you guys are honest, if you're not spies, if you're the real thing, go home, bring little Benjamin back. I just want to see that you're telling me the truth. Well, when they get home, their dad's like, no way am I sending Benjamin. I mean, Joseph's dead. Simeon had been bound and put in prison. He goes, you're not getting Benjamin. So he leaves his son Simeon in prison down in Egypt. But now they're hungry again. And he says, hey, you guys, go get us some more food down there in Egypt. And they begin to remind him, Judah, that is, as we just saw, hey, this guy said, don't come back because you're not going to see my face unless you bring little Benjamin. Their dad gets kind of hot here, and he starts saying, why did you have to tell him about Benjamin? And he said, hey, he started asking us questions about our family. He asked about our father and if we had any other brothers and people's health and such. How could we know he was going to say, bring down your brother Benjamin to us? So though his father is absolutely bummed and against this whole thing, he finally gives in. And look down with me, because I'm just catching you up, because we're kind of getting the bird's eye view, looking at a little broader portion this morning. And so I'll tell some of it, and then we'll read some of it. But anyway, finally, their father concedes in verse 11 and says, well, if it must be so, let it be. And then he says, take some of the best fruits of this land. They give him a little balm and honey and spices and myrrh and pistachio nuts, almonds, things they had on hand, but they needed grain. And he says, take some of that. Also take double money. Why? Their money had been returned to them in their sacks. So they open their sacks and they're like, oh my gosh, we got our money back. What's this all about? Did they think that was great? Not at all. They were absolutely terrified. They thought God was out to get them. Something was about to go wrong. So he finally says, take this stuff, take your brother and arise and go back to the man. And verse 14, and may God Almighty give you mercy before the man that he may release your other brother and Benjamin. If I am bereaved, I am bereaved. Now, at this point, we begin to see a change in these guys. We're going to see four things specifically in the life of Judah that are necessary for his repentance. Perhaps you're going through something or will at some point where God's trying to deal with your heart and this lesson will help. Or you know somebody going through something and this very simple and straightforward and practical lesson will come to mind. Well, first thing we see happening is that Judah assumes responsibility for his little brother. And I kind of skipped over that part. I want you to see it in verse 8. Judah said to Israel, his father, "Send the lad with me. We will arise and go, that we may live and not die, both we and you, and also our little ones. I myself will be surety for him." He's saying, in essence, I'll take care of him. Dad, you can trust me. I'll watch out for him. "From my hand you shall acquire him. If I do not bring him back and set him before you, then let me bear the blame forever." So he's taking responsibility for his brother. Why is this important in his repentance? Because he's the one that had sold his other brother, Joseph, as I've already shared with you. So step one in his repentance, and the process is different depending on what's happened and what's occurred and how we've sinned or blown it. He needed to assume responsibility for his little brother, and he chooses to do that here. Now we see a subplot as the next few verses are brought out, because as they get back to Egypt, they're invited to dine there. And we're going to see that Joseph is going to bless them, but he's also going to mess with them. He's not through with them. He is going to personally see that these guys get a little bit of a taste of their own medicine. Well, the men, we read in verse 15, took the present and Benjamin. They took double money in their hand, arose and went down to Egypt, and they stood before Joseph. And when Joseph saw Benjamin with them, he said to the steward, "Take him into my home, slaughter an animal, make ready. These men will dine with me at noon." And the man did as Joseph ordered, and the man brought the men into Joseph's house. Now the men were afraid because they were brought into Joseph's house, and they said, "It's because of the money which was returned in our sacks the first time. We're brought in so he may seek an occasion against us and fall upon us to take us as slaves with our donkeys." We mentioned last time that it is so blessed to have a clear conscience. And here's a group without a clear conscience, and they can't even enjoy their blessings. Here they are invited to this great feast. They're going to be given all of this stuff for free. And they're like, "Oh, God's out to get me. Something bad's about to happen." I don't know if you've experienced all that. I certainly have, because I grew up religious. What I mean by that, long before I was born again of the Spirit of God, forgiven all sin, long before I had the righteousness of Christ, I was a religious guy. I used religious terminology, went to church from time to time. I was spiritual. I just wasn't saved. And if people had asked me, "Are you a Christian?" I'd say, "Oh, yeah." Well, I mean, I wasn't Buddhist or something else, so I must have been. But the truth was, I was sort of like these guys, raised around a knowledge of God, but with no actual personal relationship to God. And just like these guys, I had my season of regret and remorse. Maybe you were there as well, where you'd get yourself in some jam and all of a sudden you got real religious. I mean, you were praying and you were even praying with vibrato. "Oh, Lord, I know, you know I love you. And oh, Lord, please forgive me. Get me out of this jam and I'll never do it again. And I'll even serve you, Lord, I promise." And then the Lord graciously, because he is gracious, gets you out of the jam and you're like, "Hey, well, thanks, God. See you next time." Although we don't say it just like that, many of us lived our lives, and some continue to live lives that way. Well, God is gracious, God is merciful, but he's also holy, and he's worthy of us honoring him, respecting him, revering him. And that's part of what these guys are learning as well. Well, they weren't able to fully enjoy at this point the blessings. Now they're going to get to where they're completely at peace, and then Joseph's going to really mess with them, and we'll talk about that here in a moment. Well, what happens is, as they come into the house, they begin to explain their situation to the steward. They say, "Listen, when we were going home, we opened our bags and our money was in there, and we didn't steal it. I mean, we brought it back to you." And he says, "Hey, don't even worry. Be at peace. Peace be with you. God has returned this treasure to you. The God of your fathers has blessed you with this money." And so he puts their minds at ease, and then having done so, he exercises hospitality, gives them some water for their feet, gives their donkeys feed. They make the banquet ready, and then Joseph comes home, and we pick up down around verse 26. When Joseph comes home, they says they brought with him the present which was in their hand of the house, bowed down before him to the earth, and then he asked them about their well-being and said, "Is your father well? The old man of whom you spoke, is he still alive?" And they answered, "Your servant, our father's in good health. He is still alive." And they bowed their heads. And he lifted his eyes and saw his brother Benjamin, his mother's son, and said, "Is this your younger brother of whom you spoke?" And he said, "God be gracious to you, my son." Now his heart yearned for his brother, so Joseph made haste and sought somewhere to weep. And he went into his chamber and wept there, and he washed his face and came out and restrained himself and said, "Serve the bread." Now, he messes with them just a little here. Now, he's done some things already. He bound Simeon earlier before their eyes to kind of give them that deja vu experience of when they had earlier bound him. Now, remember, they don't recognize Joseph, though he recognizes them. They don't recognize him because he looks like an Egyptian. He talks like an Egyptian. He walks like an Egyptian. He's got the whole Egyptian thing down. And so they just don't know. But he knows. And at this point, he separates himself as would have been an Egyptian's custom. But he does something unique. As they are seated for dinner, he has them seated from the eldest to the youngest. That had to trip them out. Because there's no way you could know just looking at a bunch of old bearded long-haired guys who's the oldest and who's the youngest. How did he know? These were his brothers. So he seats them in this thing that kind of causes them to look and wonder, but they fully haven't tripped on all this, and we'll see what comes next. Well, when it comes to little Benjamin, the last verse of this particular chapter, chapter 43, says he gave him 5 times as much as the rest. Now, I think this was even a little test. Why? We know it was envy, jealousy, hatred because of Joseph's favoritism in the family that had caused these guys to sell him in the first place. So now he's kind of saying, "I'm going to favor little Ben here and see how they respond." They don't even bat an eye. See, a real work is happening in all of them. They're just so grateful that they're not arrested, that they're not accosted, that they're enjoying this feast, that they just enjoy at this particular juncture the blessing. Well, what happens next is Joseph sets them up. And in the first 5 verses of chapter 44, he tells the steward to fill their sacks with food as much as they could carry, return their money once again in the sacks. Why? It was grace, man. He just wanted to bless his brothers in spite of all they'd done to him. And then he says, "Put my cup, the silver cup, in the mouth of the sack of the youngest," verse 2, "and his grain money," and his servant did as he had spoken. So warning comes, they hightail it out of there. As they're getting out of the city, the servant catches up with them and says, "Why have you repaid evil for good?" Verse 4, "Is this not the one from which my Lord drinks and with which he indeed practices divination? You've done evil in doing so." Now, someone asked me between services, so I wanted to just touch on it. I don't believe Joseph was into divination. That's occultism. But I think what's happening is just a part of the masquerade, the ploy to say, "Oh, that's how he knew how to seat us, and that's how he knew this, and that's how he knew that." But at this point, these guys are so sure of themselves that they basically offer up the life of whoever has stolen the cup. They're absolutely convinced not one of them would have done such a thing. And the good news is, not one of them had done such a thing. So, a couple of things. First of all, before we really get into that, I sort of adopted some things as I was raising my boys that maybe I could help some of you who are raising, especially preteens or teenagers. I sort of developed this thing where if I got into a situation where I couldn't absolutely be sure they'd done something, but I was pretty sure they'd done it and they weren't ready to cop to it, which happened now and then, I just go ahead and punish them anyway. Now, if you're thinking, "Well, that just didn't they think that was unjust?" Oh no, here's how I got around it. I just say, "Look, it, for everything I know about, I'm sure there are 10 things I never knew about, so I'm just going to go ahead and punish you for those." And it's ironic to me that that's what's really happening here. These guys, for all they'd done, had gotten away with it up to now. And now they're about to be busted for something they haven't done. Well, listen, did they deserve what they were getting? Oh, yeah, and far more. And it's true for us as well. Don't ever get into that, how could God let this happen to me kind of mentality. The real question is, how could God be so good and gracious to a guy like me? Not how could he let me suffer after all I've done for him. No, it's all I've done for him, yeah. The truth is, for every time we've been punished or been disciplined or gotten caught, there's so many times where we slid by and thought we got away. Well, we really don't. Because God loves us too much to let it go, to let us get away with it. But here's what happens. They're about to get busted. And I got to relate a story to you that I think helps shed some light on what's happening here. I don't want you to think that what Joseph's doing is necessarily approved of God. Joseph's setting these guys up. And that's sort of him getting even. But it's more than that. Because he wants to see, are they really repentant? Now, God doesn't have to set us up. That's the good news. He can look at my heart. He can look at your heart. He knows if we're repentant or not. He knows if we're just saying, oh, Lord, please, or if we really mean, Lord, I don't ever want to sin like this and hurt you again or wound people around me again. So God knows, but people can only see action. So Joseph is setting up a situation where he can see if these guys are really repentant. Now, some years back, I had an extraordinary experience. We have this friend. I'll call her Pam just to protect the innocent. Good friend of Pam and my Pam and myself. But anyway, she had moved away, and she had this experience where she was actually instrumental in leading her brother-in-law to the Lord. But it was kind of a shady deal, and I bring it out just to say that sometimes God allows things or things happen that turn out pretty good, and we don't want to think, oh, wow, he must have really wanted that or planned that himself. God never plans deceit or sin. He can override it and overcome it. But anyway, the story itself is kind of fascinating. She had moved down to a new area where her sister, who's a real practical jokester, was living. And her sister wanted to kind of, you know, set her up and do a little joke. So what she did is she called and pretended to be the welcome wagon, leaving a message on Pam's, we'll call her Pam anyway, don't know if that's really her name. But we'll say Pam, and she leaves her a message saying, hey, this is the welcome wagon. We left you a real nice big basket with fruit and nuts and cheeses and wine and everything. It'll be there at your house, or if you weren't there, then maybe they'll leave it at your neighbor's. Well, Pam comes home, and of course, there's no basket because it's a hoax. And so she looks and goes to her neighbors and knocks on the door, and she's kind of an intense person, so they're like freaked out, and she's like, you got my basket? And they're like, basket of what? You know, so she goes up and down the block, so now they think she's a nutcase, right? She finally calls the welcome wagon and says, hey, nobody has my basket. And they're like, your basket of what? You know, and even they didn't know what she was talking about. Then she figured it out. It was her sister. So she had to get her back. And she decides, one day her sister calls her, and they wanted to get their baby, her sister that is, and her husband, who weren't Christians, Pam and her husband are, though they don't always act like it. Anyway, they wanted to get their little baby baptized. Well, Pam goes to a Calvary Chapel down there, and they don't baptize babies. Just like us, we dedicate babies. So she says, well, you know, we dedicate. And they say, well, I don't know. I think we really want a baptism. And without getting into all of it, they just checked around some churches and found one that was willing to do it, but they had to become members. Now, they didn't have to become Christians, just members. And so they said, oh, that's okay, then we'll join. And one of the questions they asked them, though, had to do with how much money they made. Because it turned out they were interested in sort of sending them a bill for a tithe. Now, if you don't know what a tithe is, that's just a tenth of your income. Does God demand it, or do we? I don't think so. Does God bless the giving? Oh, absolutely. But anyway, without digressing into that, to get to the end of this story without making it too long, what happens is they go to this church, and Pam decides she wants to use this whole scene to pay her sister back. So she calls up the church, and the church has already suggested these guys should be giving something, but they haven't demanded it. Well, Pam calls the church and says, look, I wrote a check to you for a few hundred dollars, I don't remember the exact amount, and I'm just trying to balance my checkbook, and I never got my check back. Would you check your records and then just call me back and leave a message on my answer phone? And if you didn't get it, just say, hey, I never got your check. And, you know, we need that check. And so, of course, she leaves her sister's number. And they check, and there's no check. And they call back her sister and say, hey, we never got any check from you. And she goes to her husband, and she's all upset. She's like, man, they're calling, demanding a check from us. And it's better than that. It's way better. While they're freaking out over this whole thing, Pam puts a friend up to calling the house, pretending to be from the church. And the guy calls and says, hi, I'm from so-and-so church, and I just want to let you know, since your check was lost and we didn't get it, we're going to go ahead and send an altar boy over to collect, and we'll just deduct the $20 or $10 for whatever the lost check fee would be, and you just go ahead and write out a new check, and we'll send over the altar boy. Well, these guys were, like, going crazy. The husband was so upset, and the wife was all upset, and then she's like, well, what happens if I don't do it? They said, well, rescind the baptism. I got to admit, this is a bad practical joke. But there's a reason I'm telling it to you. These guys were so upset and so embarrassed, they could never go back to that church, see? So instead, the next week, they visited the Calvary Chapel with her sister, who she didn't know at this time had perpetrated this whole hoax. But because it was a Calvary, there was an altar call, an invitation to receive Jesus at the end of the service. And lo and behold, her husband received the Lord at the service. So Pam goes around saying, see, the Lord gave me this thing. I want to suggest that God never moves on us to be deceitful or to pull one over on someone. But God is so together that he can even use a knucklehead like that in a situation where everything was wrong to bring someone to Jesus. Well, how does that fit into our story here? Well, I think Joseph's in sin. I really do. I think that he has every right to try to feel these guys out, but he has set them up to falsely accuse them. Could God have done this another way? I think so. I don't know how. I just want to make sure you know that God isn't blessing Joseph's sin. He's blessing Joseph in spite of his sin. And he's restoring this family. Why? He's a God of restoration. He's a God of reconciliation. That's the very ministry that he's given to us, reconciling people to him, reconciling people to one another. Well, as the guy comes out and accuses them, they say, listen, whoever's got it, you can kill him and the rest of us will be your slaves. Now, that's a bad offer, by the way. He doesn't take him up on it. He says, no, I'll tell you what, whoever has the cup, that one will be my slave. And the rest of you, well, you can just hit it home. So they go, and from the eldest again down to the youngest, they begin to search each bag. What do you think happens? Well, we know the bag had been, or the silver cup had been planted in little bins, his bag. And so when they open it up, there it is. And now we get to see real repentance, not just in Judah, but in the whole family. What happens is he searches and finds it in Benjamin's sack. We pick up at verse 13. Then they, that's all 10, tore their clothes, and each one loaded his donkey and returned to the city. And Judah and his brothers came to Joseph's house while he was still there. They fell before him on the ground, and Joseph said, what deed is this you've done? Don't you know a man like me can certainly practice divination? And Judah said, what shall we say to my Lord? What shall we speak, or how shall we clear ourselves? God has found out the iniquity of your servants. Here we are, my Lord's slaves, both we and he also with whom the cup was found. So there's a confession of sin. They're saying, man, we're busted. We're guilty people. Not guilty of this. Now, they do believe at this point that Benjamin stole the cup. But Joseph knows the truth. And what he's observing is them grieving over this situation at this point, as we find Judah doing three more things. Not only had he already said, hey, I'll take care of my brother. That was a major change, and that was the first change. We noticed it in the past chapter. Now we find him as the blanks are filled in and the story develops. We find his second evidence of repentance is he identifies with Benjamin in his sin. He says, you found the iniquity of your servants. We are here, your slaves, both we and he also, as we just read, verse 16, with whom the cup was found. He said, look it, I'm not leaving my little brother behind. If he's going to be a slave, I'm going to be a slave. He not only promised his father to take care of him, but he identified with him in his sin. He offered to share in his punishment. That's a radical change of heart. That is more than remorse and regret. That is a real evidence of repentance. When you're willing to suffer for someone else's sin instead of being the one making people suffer as a result of your sin. Well, Joseph's response in verse 17 is, no, Ben will do. You guys just go on home and I'm sure everything will be just fine. And go in peace to your father, he concludes saying. Listen, there's no way they could go at peace to their father. And this kind of brings him out, if you will. We see Judah's concern for his father expressed. Now, there was absolute callousness on their part when they sold Joseph earlier into slavery. They didn't care if it hurt their father. They didn't care what happened to Joseph. They were just envious and hateful, and they acted out. But now, Judah comes near and says, verse 18, oh, my Lord, let your servant speak a word in my Lord's hearing, and don't let your anger burn against your servant, for you are like Pharaoh. He begins to give him the story, and we've already considered it, how when they went back, you know, after he told him, you're not coming back without your brother, we went and told our dad, and then he didn't want to send Ben, but then he sent Ben, and finally, he says, I can't go back without him. He says in verse 29, recalling the words of his father, if you take this one also from me and calamity befalls him, you'll bring my gray hair with sorrow to the grave. Now therefore, when I come to your servant, my father, and the lad is not with us, since his life is bound up in the lad's life, it will happen when he sees the lad is not with us that he will die. And your servants will bring down the gray hair of your servant, our father, with sorrow to the grave. So he's promised to take care of his brother. He's identified with his brother and that he was willing and offering himself to share in his punishment. And now he's showing real care and concern for his father. That's a third evidence of his repentance. And then there's a fourth, and this is the finest of all. He goes on in verse 32, having gotten this far, he says, for your servant became surety for the lad to my father, saying, if I don't bring him back to you, I shall bear the blame before my father forever. Now, therefore, please let your servant remain instead of the lad as a slave to my Lord, and let the lad go up with his brothers. For how shall I go up to my father if the lad is not with me, lest perhaps I see the evil that would come upon my father? He offers himself a living sacrifice. Now, I wish we had time to go ahead, but here's the good news. You don't have to wait till next week to see what happens. It's not like some soap opera. You've got the text. And if you don't have a Bible, we're happy to give you one before you leave and read ahead. See what's coming. But I want to share three final things before we worship together. Three ways, and in all of them we've just examined. Three more ways that we can see Jesus. Now listen, we have been looking at how Joseph's life pointed us to the life of Jesus. Now we see Judah's life pointing us to Jesus. It's worth noting that Jesus would come in the line of Judah. He's called the Lion of the tribe of Judah. But three things. Jesus identified with us, even as Judah said, listen, I want to suffer with him. I want to be a slave with him. Jesus did that very thing when he took upon himself the form of flesh, when he was born of the Virgin Mary, when he experienced all of the physical and emotional and mental stresses and trials and tribulations we go through, when he experienced every single temptation we've ever experienced, tempted in all ways, we're told, yet without sin. Jesus fully identified with us by becoming one of us. He also, while he came to redeem us, had something else in mind. He was looking at the Father. He did always those things that pleased the Father, and he didn't want to see the Father's heart break. And you need to know that more than anger or frustration or any attribute we might ascribe to God, God's heart breaks when he sees his beloved in sin, when he sees his beloved rebelling and running against or running from him. So he knew the Father's heart would break, and he didn't want it to happen. Finally, he offered himself for us. As surely as Judas said, "Let me take his place," he would have become a living sacrifice. Jesus died, we're told, a sacrifice for our sin. "No man takes my life from me," Jesus will later say. "I have power to lay it down and power to take it up again. This command I've received from my Father." Jesus identified with us. He saw the Father's broken heart, and then he said, "Let me take their place." And that's exactly what happened on Calvary. If you can't comprehend, or you've yet to comprehend, why Jesus died on the cross, here's why. The Bible says the wages of sin is death. That's what we deserve, death. Physical death is in the world because of sin, but he's talking about something much worse. What's worse than physical death? Spiritual death, separation from God eternally. And because sin separates, Jesus came and died for our sins. As he hung on that cross, he said, "Father, forgive them. They know not what they do." But he wasn't just asking for our forgiveness. He was providing for it. He made him, we sing, who knew no sin, to be sin for us that we might become the righteousness of God. We have imputed to us this attribute of rightness before God, for that's all that righteousness really means. We're just right in God's sight, imputed to us. We couldn't earn it. We couldn't deserve it. We couldn't create it. So he says, "Look it, I'll trade all your sin for my son's righteousness, for his rightness." What's our part in the deal? We have to receive it. And as surely as we see this in the passage, God requires of us repentance. Not just regret or remorse or even confession. Because you can regret your sin and have remorse for it and even confess that you did it, but not turn from it. And today God's asking those who've yet to receive Jesus, turn from the sin of unbelief. Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved. Receive him and you'll be born again, forgiven all sin. Believers, you know how it works out. If we confess our sin, he's faithful and just to forgive us and cleanse us of how much unrighteousness, all unrighteousness. So we're going to bow our heads, and I'm going to ask all believers, first of all, to pray for any and all unbelievers in our midst as they wrestle with this decision, fight this spiritual battle. And Lord, we do lift up those you've drawn in today, whose hearts you're stirring, who, Lord, without any law, without a thou shalt not or a thou shalt, know in their inner man, their conscience convicting, that just like us, they're sinners. And Lord, there's that dread and that fear of the future because they know they're not right with you. And inherently, Lord, you've placed within them that sense that there's no way they can make it. There's no way they can atone. And so I pray that you, Lord, would cement the reality of these truths in hearts today. That you are the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by you. That you are the resurrection and the life. That you are the only door. Lord, I pray that not one here would be lost to you. And even now, if there'd be any or many who've never given your life to the Lord Jesus, listen. He became one of us, lived as one of us, died for each of us, was buried and rose again the third day, ascended into heaven, and even now, he's there at the right hand of the throne of the Father praying for you, but you need to make a decision. And if you end up in hell, and hell's real, you won't be able to say, "I didn't really understand it. It was never clearly explained to me." No, it's been clearly explained, and you can comprehend. There's no such thing as "I can't believe. There's only I won't believe. And so today, if you do believe and you've never received Jesus, I'd ask you to raise your hand and hold it high. If you've never said, Lord, come into my life, forgive me every sin, be my Lord and Savior, it's not enough to be religious. He demands a total and perfect righteousness. You don't possess it, but He'll give it, impute it, His gift. Anyone this hour, anyone this service, if that's you, raise your hand, hold it high, and allow me to pray for and with you today. Anyone at all, God bless you. I see your hand there in the middle. Others here today, you can put your hand on after I acknowledge you, brother. Others here today, if you're ready to say yes to the Lord Jesus as well, anybody else, if the Lord's convicted you of His love for you and your need for Him, just another moment. Lord, for this brother and any others whose hearts are just pounding and their mind is saying, oh, yes, Lord, I pray that as they open their hearts to You, that You'll fill them and flood them with the assurance of forgiveness and salvation, that You'll fill them to overflowing with Your Holy Spirit, that they can be from moment one a witness unto the world around them of Your grace and Your mercy toward them. And you who raise your hand and any others who are ready to pray and receive Jesus today, believers, if you want to pray along, feel free. Pray these words aloud. Heavenly Father, thank You for choosing me, for sending Jesus to die for me, for drawing me here, for revealing my need and Your plan. I confess I'm a sinner. Give me the power, the strength to truly repent, to turn from unbelief and a life of sin to a life of belief and serving You. I give You my life. Be my Lord and Savior. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's welcome this brother into the family.